welcome. I'm Doug Albright, working with Carl Ortman and Dick Cargan. We're on the campus of Loyola College, Evergreen Field, and it's a neutral site as the NCAA Division I champions, North Carolina Tar Heels, about ready to do battle with the Division III champions from last year, Hobart College.
Yeah, I'm excited about this game from one standpoint, and that's as an old crease attackman. I love to see a team that gets that ball inside to the crease and gets those easy goals. And they've got one of the best, I think, in the game in Wingate, and they don't mind giving that ball to him.
These are two really outstanding teams. You look at the depth of North Carolina. They have a lot of experience, guys that have been around for a couple of years, been playing major college ball. This is going to be an outstanding game. Hobart, on the other hand, is the same thing. There's a power from up in New York State. They've won this championship for years. You got two guys that have been coaching for only 4 years. This is their fourth season, and between the two of them, they've become two of the best coaches, better coaches in the country.
And Willie Scroggs, of course, has loaded his North Carolina squad with Baltimore-bred lacrosse players. Of course, the state of North Carolina has not had a big lacrosse program in their high schools. I understand they're making some moves towards changing that, but he's done a very good job recruiting in this area. Consequently, he is a national power division champion 2 years in a row.
We have a couple of brother acts out there today, too. The Vocals brothers, Brett and Pete, and then we have the Haas brothers, Tom and John, on defense for Carolina.
And, of course, on the other hand, Hobart recruiting mostly from the New York, Long Island area and upstate New York. They've been a power for quite some time. They might not have the depth that North Carolina has, but they know how to win. And we'll be back with the start of today's ball game right after these messages.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus, the dream a reality, the illusion a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck, in stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
We went over the figures, and I found out I was saving thousands of dollars.
When I went to purchase my dream car, a Datsun 280ZX, I shopped the Baltimore, Washington area, and I found my best deal here at Town & Country Datsun.
When you start saving $900 to $1,000 on a deal, something like that, I mean, years per bit.
The deal was really good.
Town & Country Pontiac Datsun, located 2 miles north of Beltway Exit 32. If it's not a Town & Country deal, it's not your best deal.
We're just a couple of minutes away from the start of our Battle of Champions here at Loyola College Evergreen Field. Division I champs from last year, North Carolina, against the Division III champs, Hobart. And it looks as though both clubs are going to be very strong again. And I'd imagine that in their respective divisions, they'd be favored to be the division champs once again.
Certainly appears that way. It looks as though last year you end up the season with Carolina number one, Virginia two, Hopkins three, Cornell four, Army five. You once again, you've got Carolina coming back with 30 kids from last year's squad. A lot of balance. They did lose a good face-off man, but I'm sure that Willie Scroggs worked on replacing him. So you've got, obviously, I think they're certainly the favorite.
And, of course, their main competition will come from traditional power Johns Hopkins, and I'm sure Virginia will be quite strong again. On the other hand, in Division III, Hobart, most likely, certainly the class of the division again. They were the best team last year as they won it going away. Washington College, Roanoke, Salisbury, and Denison were their main competition, finishing 2 through 5 in the final poll.
Look for Washington College again to give them a good run for their money. But somehow over the years, Hobart has had some sort of spell over Washington College. I think in the last 4 or 5 years, they've won 3 or 4 of the games in overtime. So I'd say Hobart's got a real good chance of winning again.
And we'll be back with the start of today's game in just a couple of moments.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus, the dream a reality, the illusion a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck, and stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
It's the Statesmen against the Tar Heels, the Division III champions against the powerhouse North Carolina champions in Division I lacrosse last year as they defeated Johns Hopkins. We're at Evergreen Field, the campus of Loyola College here in Baltimore, a neutral site. Both teams had about the same distance to travel, Hobart coming down from the North Country and Carolina coming up from down on Tobacco Road.
One thing to look for in this game that we haven't talked about a great deal is the fact that we've got some good defenses here, especially when you consider Tommy Sears in the goal for North Carolina, probably one of the best ball players in the country today.
Yeah, there are people that say that today's game will match maybe the 1 and 2 goalie in the country, in Dan Arsdale and Sears. On the other hand, you look at Hobart, who has some outstanding outside shooters, and their premier shooter being a fellow named O'Hare. Who can really put the ball on the goal, and was going to be threatening Sears a lot, and will be forcing. On the other hand, you've got John, you have the Tar Heels with their boy Wingate inside, who's going to be tough to hold. I know that Hobart, in discussions with some of their people, are very concerned about Wingate because he is so strong, and so it's an interesting encounter here.
He brings one thing to the game that is very important. He gets open, he knows how to get open, and he is open most of the time.
Sort of interesting that Carolina, of course, as we mentioned, most of their ball players from the general Baltimore area. Willie Scroggs has recruited heavily up here, and they've done wonders for the lacrosse programs on the high school level down in North Carolina. They've given the game instant credibility down there, and I understand that the North Carolina players are getting caught up in it also. They're running a lot of programs for the youngsters, all the way down from 6 years of age and on up, going out having a lot of clinics. So it won't be long before Willie Scruggs will be able to get some homegrown talent on his North Carolina team, which can do nothing but help collegiate sports, lacrosse.
Oh, exactly. I know that in the Winston-Salem area, Greensboro, they get tremendous coverage in the newspapers down there. All that helps. And Virginia's done that for a good long time, too. And they're not just close enough together that they can help each other out, along with Duke and some of the other schools in the conference.
And there are the Division I champions, the North Carolina Tar Heels, as they begin to take the field. Hobart still huddled around their coach, Dave Urich. And we've got the starting lineups moments away.
Dick, what does Dave Urich tell his ball players about how to start off this game today?
I think he wants to start them out under control. I think, matter of fact, probably both teams do. I think you want to go out and box and spar a little bit and see what you've got. I think they want to find out about their face-off situation. Can they get in control of the face-off? Be important to them. First face-off might be will establish a pattern for the game today.
Here's the starting attack. Grimaldi, Morfitt, and Eckerson for Hobart. And now the starting midfield with number 30, Mike Walker. There's the starting lineup, Malloy, Walker, and Mulvey. And now the starting defense for the Hobart Statesmen. First game of the year for both of these clubs. So I'm sure everyone, a few butterflies, a little bit tight, and quite anxious. You practice and you practice and you practice, and this is what you're practicing for, to get the season underway. Everyone anxious to get this 1983 season off for these two champion teams. And there's the defensive squad with Guy Van Aersdale anchoring it as the goalie.
The other thing today is, with this weather the way it is, if you're going to start off slow normally, this weather's going to hold you back a little, even a little bit more than that.
I think the wind is going to be a factor. I believe that concentration on a day like this is probably more important than on a beautiful, bright, sunshiny day. You've got to concentrate on your offense. You've got to pay attention to the people who are talking about backing up and movement and picking up. All those things are important.
There's our starting attack for North Carolina with Burnett, Vogel, and Dave Wingate, who we spoke of earlier, and a very fine attack.
The other factor here is that the coaches sometimes... Go ahead.
There's our starting midfield, Pete Vogel, Andy Smith, and Jeff Hohmeyer. And for North Carolina, starting defense, John Haas, captain of the squad, along with Cox. And, of course, in the goal is Tom Sears. And Sears, one of the fine goalies in lacrosse today.
There's Willie Scroggs. Willie is a fine gentleman and an excellent coach. He's turned that program completely around in the short amount of time he's been there.
You know, a couple of years ago when Johns Hopkins played North Carolina, this Peter Vogel, in my opinion, on that given day was the unsung hero of that game. He made some tremendous plays on loose balls and got the ball downfield quickly. He's quite an athlete.
Facing off will be Mike Walker for Hobart against Andy Smith for Carolina. Carolina in that Carolina blue with the white shorts and the white numbers. They'll go from our left to our right. Hobart in the blue and orange. And we're underway from Evergreen Field at Loyola. It's Hobart and North Carolina. Doug Albright, along with Carl Ortman and Dick Cargan, glad to have you along for NCAA lacrosse.
Here comes. Hobart gained possession, but then lost it quickly.
Sure did. So characteristically in college lacrosse, right away they get the long sticks in the ball game. So Hobart has six defensemen in there right now.
And it's North Carolina working the ball. That's Pete Vogel with the left hand, and he's guarded nicely there by Scott Geis. And Geis comes up with a loose ball for Hobart, tries to get it over to Tim Clark. It's into Hobart's offensive end, but Carolina comes up with a loose ball. That's Jeff Hohmeyer. This will set the players for you. That pass now to Brent Vogel, as we had a number change just prior to the game. Vogel wearing number 7, and now Mike Burnett. Burnett works against Tim Clark, And he fires it outside near the restraining line. Now working in the attack zone for North Carolina. Shot by Smith is knocked away by Van Aerstel.
Good
move. Hobart comes up with the ball.
Excellent movement on the goaltender's part that time. He moved out to the ball with that stick up. Took the shot away, took the angle away.
So Hobart will try to clear it out of their end. John Cypher, and he's a big one, 6'1", 200 pounds, a senior out of Cortland. And the guy, Van Aerstel, also another senior. A lot of veterans on this Hobart team. Now across midfield, the pass from Mulvey, and it's taken away by North Carolina. Here come the Tar Heels. No score. We're just underway. 13:27 left in first quarter action.
Both teams seem to be trying to feel each other out right now to see what they can get away with and what they can do.
And a loose ball now to Hobart, as indeed it's like two boxers in the early going of a boxing match. No one really taking the initiative. Pass all the way across the field, and Hobart now tries to work the clear. Here comes Don Malloy, and he's being cluttered closely there by Pete Vogel. Now Malloy in the
Malloy,
attack zone.
Malloy, man, a nice play. I'm telling you, Malloy's just coming off an injury. He doesn't look like he's hurt to me.
Yeah, it does look pretty good on that. Flag's
and
down.
There's got a flag, and now Morfitt will work the ball for Hobart, as he's guarded closely there by John Hawes, and pass behind the goal as Hobart continues to work the ball. That's Grimaldi, and he has it stripped away. And there's our first penalty of the game.
One of the things to notice there was that even though the flag was down, play continued until the ball was not in an offensive posture. In fact, it was taken away. And then the play is stopped, and the foul is awarded.
Gives Hobart obviously the first extra man play of the game. Be interesting to see how they set up. I understand they set up in a 2-3-1 and rotate into a 1-4-1.
Well, they're all six out front right now, Dick, and I think what they're going to try and do is get the North Carolina zone to pick up a man, but they don't seem to be doing that right now. They're going to have to walk down on that zone. Here he comes.
And they're going to move into it.
Yeah.
Now they work it around. That's Malloy.
There he is.
And he works the ball now to Zajdil, and just inside the restraining line right now as they're a man up and shot and a save for Tom Sears.
Not a good shot. Shot was not on the goal. Shot was taken way out too far, and they hadn't moved the ball behind the goal yet, and they had just moved their man back there.
Especially on this AstroTurf where the bounce is true. That shot is not going to go.
Indeed, the turf does make it a little bit of a different game. Now Sears works the ball back now to Tom Haas for North Carolina. And on the far side of the field, that's Randy Cox.
Hobart is being very tenacious in this ride. Very tenacious.
I was going to say, Hobart, unlike Carolina, tends to go after the man with the ball while Carolina sits back and waits.
And coming up momentarily there with the ball was Scott Geis for Hobart. He couldn't handle it.
We have a broken play situation here, but Carolina elects to pull out of it.
And that's Brent Vogel setting up the offense for Carolina, and he works the ball now to Bill Ness. Carolina now going to show some patience as they set up the offense. Mike Burnett, and his pass is knocked away. Hobart comes up with the loose ball, and here comes Zajdil, his pass now to Hollihan.
This is not a broken play. See if they settle down. Good move.
Good
idea.
We've played 4.5 minutes here at first quarter action.
The boxers are out there sparring with each other. They're setting up a one-on-one, clearing one side, trying to allow. That's a man-for-man defense out there against Hobart. Nice play coming around. Good defensive maneuver in there. Very nice by John Hawes.
And here comes Carolina across midfield. That's Brian Rice inside the restraining area now. His pass goes to Brent Vogel. And Vogel, shot taken. Wingate. There you go. We've got a score, I believe. We're screened out here.
Good movement. The Carolina team kept the ball moving very quickly.
Here it is again.
Had Hobart a little bit of disarray.
But Brian Rice. Brian Rice was the man who was given credit for that goal. And with 10 minutes and 1 second left, it's a 1-0 North Carolina lead over the Statesmen of Hobart.
Once again, there you see the premium of moving the ball on offense. It creates so many openings. Even then, an offensive play started. The ball was loose. The ball got moved around a little bit, and another play was created.
Steidel will face off against Walker, and Hobart comes up with the face-off in the person of Don Malloy, and he has it taken away. Carolina has it again. Now it's Mike Burnett and his shot off the mark, and coming up with the loose ball is Brent Vogel.
Hobart also is in a man for man. Both teams with the talent, they don't need to go to a zone. I think they had a hold on this one.
Burnett making a move toward the goal, and he was held.
Carolina will go up for 30 seconds to see what they set up in for an extra man play.
A 1-0 score, 9:32 left in the first quarter. We're at Evergreen Field, neutral site for these two NCAA champions in lacrosse last year.
They'll rotate into a 1-4-1 here.
Slowly working the ball in, that's Hohmeyer for Carolina.
Not quite sure there's a hold. It should be called over Carolina. I think we had a good acting thing situation out there.
They call it a hold. A hold on Hobart. I think it's one of those you can talk about for a little while. Could have been on either player.
And Van Aerstel comes up with the save, and his clearing pass for Sean Fox is thrown away. It's picked up there by North Carolina, and they clear it with John Hawes.
Sideline play over there.
Well, it's a situation where a guy came in out of bounds at the end of a penalty and caught the guy napping.
What do you got for a reading?
So it remains Carolina 1 and Hobart nothing, and Hobart has the ball. Far side of the field, that's Jim Holohan.
This looks like we've got our basic 1-on-1 coming.
And Holohan tries to work on Kester, and he has it knocked away there by Tom Hawes, and here comes North Carolina.
Excellent play by Hawes to come out and double team when he turned his back.
And that Carolina offense, this is Crosby. He works the ball to David Wingate. That's the man that Hobart really has to contain. His feet on the crease there for Vogel. Vogel had it knocked away, and the ball is picked up and shot taken there by, it looked like, Kester, and Carolina was back. They'll keep the ball.
I got a feeling that Hobart ought to start putting some people on the ground. They're standing around a little bit much. The ball's on the ground. You got two or three Hobart guys and one Carolina guy, and the Carolina guy's coming up with the ball. Shouldn't be.
Once again, we got the long sticks in the game. So you've got six defensemen in there.
Burnett working against Clark, and his shot is knocked away. Van Aerstel with a good job, almost knocked in though by Wingate, and loose ball scooped up there by Mac Ford.
Dick, it seems as though Van Aerstel really gets into a position where he feels he's got the goal covered, and he just stands there. He doesn't move much.
He sure does. But he's quite large. He's a good-sized boy, and he does cover the goal well, and I think he understands geometry. He steps away from the pipe the right way every time.
Carolina showing their depth as they've run quite a few players into the ball game here in the early going. That's Mac Ford now working behind the goal for the Tar Heels, and he fires the ball out there to Andy Smith, and Smith, his shot is off the mark. Carolina keeps possession.
If you notice, they've tried just about a little of everything to see what'll work. They've tried the one-on-one from behind. They've tried the flip to the midfielder. They've tried a few plays.
7:26 left, first quarter action. It's Carolina 1, Hobart nothing, and we'll be back.
Oh, I know I saved a tremendous amount of money. I saved over $1,000 on my deal on the Pulsar. And I don't think I would have gotten that anywhere else but Town and Country.
Town and Country, I think I saved about $1,000.
I saved $1,800 on my Town and Country deal.
Well, I got $2,702 off my card.
So I figured I saved about $1,100, $1,200.
Town and Country Pontiac Dodson, located 2 miles north of Beltway Exit 32. If it's not a Town and Country deal, it's not your best deal.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citations, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus, the dream a reality, the illusion a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
North Carolina has the ball, enjoying a one-goal lead. 7:24 left here in the first quarter. Nats Mike Burnett working in the attack area there against Tim Clark for Hobart. And the pass is thrown away on the far side. It goes back to the Statesman.
Interesting play coming across. There was no pick there, Carl.
It's they're trying to find something, and they haven't found it yet. I think they have so much confidence in their crease that they'll just go in there, even with a man on it most of the time.
First game for both clubs, gentlemen. Does that change the style of play at all? Do you try to do anything differently, knowing that it's the first game for both teams?
I would say from a North Carolina standpoint, they've got the same players, and they know what got them to where they got last year, so they're going to stay with it.
Nice
play.
Pass there to Mike Walker for Hobart. And Hobart now in their offensive end. They'll try to tie the score. That's Grimaldi.
Oh, Grimaldi went around him like he was water.
He got Sears out of the crease. Grimaldi makes a nice move, and it's tied at one. Here it is again. Hopefully we'll get a chance to see that nice one-on-one move.
This is such a quick beating of the man right there that Sears has to come out of the goal, and there's no backup.
Cox made a terrible error. Cox moved out towards Grimaldi so quickly that it just took one fake for Grimaldi to hit and go. I think we'd all like to have a defenseman run at us like that, wouldn't we?
And then to have the closest midfielder out at the restraining line.
So the Division III champions have tied the Division I champs. It's a 1-1 game, 6:43 left in our first quarter action. And our faceoff is going to be handled by Hobart. That's Pat O'Hara. Here come the Statesmen again. Jim Holohan inside the restraining line, and they'll set up that offense far side of the field to Morfin.
Here's a stack inside. They're setting up a three-man pick in there, and they all roll off, but nothing's there.
Pass goes to Grimaldi. As he works against Randy Cox for Carolina, and the ball knocked away, it comes to North Carolina.
Nice check. He used the butt end of the stick instead of using the top end, a very popular thing to do.
And now Hobart works it into play, and despite the fact that we've got some chilly temperatures, high winds, very good crowd here at Evergreen Field to see these two division champions from last season. An overflow crowd, and they're still coming in the gates.
You don't get the chance to see North Carolina much in this area, and to have them here so early in the season, everybody's hungry to see them.
Indeed, first game for both ball clubs, and a lot of lacrosse fans coming out of the woodwork to see this one.
Carl, Hobart's playing a lot of patience right now, aren't they? They want to keep that ball. They want to control the ball.
I'm very surprised to see the kind of offense they've gone into here. they're really trying a little bit more of one-on-one than I expected them to.
Yeah. Would any of us have believed that they played almost 10 minutes and only two goals were scored?
Holahan had a good low shot and was unable to connect. 5.5 minutes left, first quarter. We're tied at one.
I hope Hobart's back in their zone.
Now, they've changed it. The last time they were a man on, and now they've dropped back into a six-across zone here with the six up.
And Carolina clears it nicely. Good pass across midfield. That's Seibold.
Carolina may have too good a stick work to be able to pull a zone against them. Here's a shot coming.
Steidel, he shoots and scores. Ward Steidel, junior midfield out of Warburg, Pennsylvania. Number 31, Steidel, puts Carolina up by 2-1.
Steidel was able to pull that off because when he went by his man, the attackman on that side had cleared the side for him, so there was no backup. Consequently, he had a great opportunity to score unmolested.
And there's the man who's put Carolina up 2-1 with 5:01 left in the first quarter. And Steidel will face off. And doing the chores for Hobart will be Mike Walker.
Interesting stance the Hobart man takes.
And it's knocked into Carolina's end, and it's scooped up there by North Carolina's Dave Wingate. Wingate being hounded there by John Edney, and Edney will have his hands full throughout the day. Now, Mark Ford. And back outside, Seibold. He'll crank and score!
So Joey's had that shot for quite a few number of years, and it's a tough shot to stop. He comes from way back and lets her go.
There's Seibold out of Parkton, and here it is again. And you'll see a low, hard shot.
Whew. Stick side high, and I don't think he still sees it.
A good one-on-one effort.
Seibold, just a freshman out of Parkton, playing for a national champion and scores in his first quarter of collegiate play. He's got to be excited.
Man, that's a big opportunity for a kid.
And face off, we've got a penalty.
Joey Seibold's father at one time was a coach of Mount Washington, an all-time club player at Mount Washington, an All-American. And he went to Washington College, where I went. He went to Mount Washington, was a star there up until about age 37 or 38, and then coached Mount Washington for a while. So that's a family tradition right there.
It looks like Joey Seibold is going to keep that tradition going.
Hey.
Brent Vogel, and he gets it now to Mac Ford for North Carolina. They lead 3-1. And Ford trying to find an opening and has it stripped away. And loose ball comes to North Carolina's Mike Martin. And what do we got here? It's going to go back to Hobart.
Let's see if Carolina stays in that zone or if they jump into a man for man.
They got a point man in there, Carl. Now they're going to drop back.
Up.
Well, that takes care of that.
And the pass.
One bad pass will certainly destroy any kind of...
The best ride in town.
So North Carolina will get the ball back. They lead 3-1 on two lightning quick goals after Hobart had fought back to tie it at one apiece.
Over the years, the strength of Carolina has been to take the broken situation and convert it every time. All even, they're basically a one-on-one type of club that dishes it off when they get trapped by another man. There's a bad pass, it'll turn over.
Hobart will get the ball back on that bad pass and looking to close within a goal. Now there's the goalie for Hobart, Van Aersdale, senior out of Geneva. And now the pass is going to be out of bounds. Oh. Ward Stidell, a junior out of Warbreath, PA. And, of course, he's the guy who scored that goal just prior to Seidel's. And now Tom Sears for Carolina brings it into play, and they'll clear it upfield. 3:13 left here in the first quarter.
Hobart's got everybody involved in their ride this time.
Yeah, as I said before, I think it's going to be tough for them to try and ride Carolina with their stick work in a zone. They're going to have to put a little more pressure on the Sears to move the ball field.
That's Kester for Carolina, and he dishes the ball off to Martinello. Martinello being hounded there by O'Hara, and gets it behind the net to Vogel.
A lot of moving in on the crease there. Watch for moving picks, because these guys are very active inside. Good check.
Good check there from Cipher, and loose ball.
Excellent check
up.
And a very cute play there. Very cute play. Here's very clever.
It's a 4-on-3 if they
might have
completed.
A fast break. We got one.
And here comes Hobart. They've got Pat O'Hara.
Hit the point, man. Hit the side, man. Nice play by Sears.
Hobart with a good opportunity right there and some good defensive work. And there's Tom Sears, the fine goalie for North Carolina, who made that play.
Now watch Tommy Sears here. He's going to anticipate that shot down. That's an incredible reaction to get down that fast with a man right on top of you. Here's a multi-stack on the crease. It's a one-on-one and then a flip.
Morfitt tries to feed it into the hole there, and loose ball is knocked around. Shot taken by Zajdal, and there we got a penalty.
Trip. We have a one-minute penalty for a trip on that one.
We got a trip. We got an irate John Haas going off his cause who did the tripping. And we'll take another look at Hobart's extra man play.
And a good opportunity for Hobart here as they trail by 2 goals at 3-1. So Hobart in their extra man.
Once again, they start with 6 men out front. And now for the play to work, he's got the ball has to come straight down the chute, and they have to make men play him. See if they're going to do it.
In the second rotation, that guy will go behind the goal, I think. Yes, he is.
Okay.
Good patience on the part of Hobart as they've got Holohan with the ball right now. And the pass, the man is open. Shot taken and a score for Don Malloy. Beautifully done.
Very well executed.
Oh, it's a very well executed play. And the patience involved in it is terrific. And the shooter is coming all the way out from the underside.
Here it is again.
It's a simple clear out of one side. The ball moves around the one side of the goal, and then there's a man who cuts through to fill out one side and clear the other, and then the ball is popped over to the backside.
The score 3-2 as Hobart gets back within 1 goal as Malloy, the senior, out of Lake Ronkonkoma, New York, scores, and it's a 3-2 ball game with 1:36 left in first quarter action.
Watch the Hobart faceoff, man. With that leg back, watch his first move. He brings the leg up anyway. It's interesting why he does that. Oh, and nice play. Oh.
Here's Vogel, and he had an opportunity but unable to scoop up the ground ball, and now gets it in the near corner. And his brother Pete now inside the restraining area, working the ball for Carolina. Hohmeyer, his shot, and he scores.
It is a beautiful shot.
Jeff Hohmeyer, a senior out of Mincola, New York, puts Carolina up 4-2.
There's no mystery to that goal. He just got up against his man and decided he was going to make one quick move left and come back right and take that shot. Here it is. Quick move left. Bang.
Nothing much the goalie Van Aerstel could do about that one.
Well, the people in Mineola, New York are very happy for I'm sure, for him right now. That was a beautiful shot. Set himself up nicely, drew himself to the left, brought over the defense, got the stick free, turned and took the shot. And he shot right away, Carl. A lot of kids don't do that.
That's right. They usually take that extra step.
So Carolina gets their lead back to 2, and we've got a little legal procedure. It's going to go to Hobart.
Once that referee sets the ball between those two men's stick, they may not move until they hear the whistle. If either one of them moves before the whistle, it's automatically turned over to the other team.
Tom Sears, the product of Calvert Hall, and he's been a stalwart in the nets for Willie Scroggs' Carolina club for a number of years. And now Sears does have the loose ball, and he'll try to clear it for North Carolina.
No.
Tommy's doing something now that most goalies I don't think want to get involved with, and that is they're trying to be cute with the ball. Uh-oh.
And now Hobart's showing a little bit of their aggressiveness. And what do we got here?
It's a push.
There's a push on Hobart on a loose ball, so the possession goes over to Carolina. A lot of action in that. I thought he was going to get trapped there for a minute. If number 11 for Hobart had moved into the center there, he would have a lot of pain.
Tommy Sears has taken a lot of chances with the ball that I don't think you'd see most people take. But Tom's a member of the world team and probably the premier goalie in the country.
Just 29 seconds left in the first quarter. It's a 4-2 ball game and a fairly well-played first quarter, especially considering this is the first game of the 83 season for both these teams. But with the talent they have, I guess they should be playing well. And there's a pass thrown away by Pete Vogel, and the ball goes back to Hobart. A lot of fans made the trek down from Hobart and up from North Carolina. And both these schools well represented as far as rooters and boosters here with them this afternoon. Now Hobart across midfield. That's Holahan inside the restraining box and looking to pass on the crease. Just 5 seconds left in the quarter. Pass and just over the head of Eckerson. And that's the end of the first quarter of play. It's Carolina 4, Hobart 2. Second quarter action in a moment.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck in stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
Mr. Nobody here at Town & Country Pontiac with All-Pro John Unitas.
Speaking of All-Pro, this has to be your All-Pro transportation. And I understand there's a $5,000 cash rebate right now on these StarCraft vans.
That's right, John. $5,000 cash rebate on any StarCraft van in stock. And look how they're equipped.
Do they all have captain chairs and tables and real teak wood?
Yes, but best of all, the $5,000 cash rebate that can be used as your down payment.
StarCraft custom vans and $5,000 cash rebates.
Town & Country Pontiac.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
For Carolina, Walker for Hobart will face off to start second quarter action. Carolina leading 4-2. They'll go from our right to our left. And Hobart in the orange and blue will go from our left to our right.
Interesting statistic from that first quarter. Shots 11-5, North Carolina. And out of those five shots, two of them went in.
And the face-off statistic surprised me a little bit because it seems like Hobart controlled each and every face-off and then lost the ball after they had control, and yet they came out pretty even, 5-4.
Morfitt for Hobart, as they cleared that side for him, and he had the ball knocked away by John Haas, and Carolina, leading 4-2, will clear the ball.
That over-the-head check of Haas is a trademark of his. He seems to be able to go over anybody's head and take the ball away, no matter what they do with it.
He's very clever and he's very quick. Of course, he's from an old lacrosse family. His father played University of Virginia, defenseman.
And Carolina gets it across midfield. That's Haas, and his pass goes to Rice.
I think that zone they're playing is not going to be enough to stop the Carolina clear. The stick work is just too good.
I agree with you. I think they ought to take a chance and do some pressure.
Rice with a nice pass and a shot whistled there by Dave Wingate. And it's a 5-2 game.
Enter David Wingate. Watch this. This is vintage Wingate. Ball behind the goal, and David and his attackman know each other. He steps out, and bang, the ball is in the goal before anybody reacts. What a quick shot.
And once again, he threw it by the goalie. He didn't put it in the corner. He didn't put it on the pipe. He just threw it past the goaltender. He can shoot so hard and with such speed.
Too much velocity for Van Aerstale to handle, and Carolina opening up a three-goal lead at 5-2. 13:56 left here in the first half. And we've got a whistle on the face-off, illegal procedure, and it will go to North Carolina.
That time, the wingman may also come in, but he has to wait for the whistle, and evidently the Hobart man stepped over.
Here's Brian Rice going one-on-one. His shot, Van Aerstale comes up with the save, and his pass over the head of the man intended for it was intended for Hollihan. And Carolina comes back again with Ness.
And now they got a 2-on-1, and it's all over.
Nicely done. Vogel hits Dave Wingate, and Wingate with two straight goals here in a matter of a minute, and it's a 6-2 Carolina lead.
On this particular goal, watch how Burnett has his head up, and he knows exactly what's going to happen when he gets the ball. Well, it's a little bit quick there, but he had his head up. He knew that the man first cutting through was going to clear the way out for Wingate on the backside. Just had the patience and threw it across.
And Wingate was parked right on the crease, right where he needed to be, and scored it easily. And it's a 4-goal lead for the Tar Heels of North Carolina. And Hobart, I'm sure, would like to get a goal right here to stem that tide.
Absolutely. So, Carl, as you said earlier, in broken play situations, Carolina just plays beautifully. That's where they picked up, I guess, the four of their goals.
Yes, they will score 80% of their goals on broken plays.
Grimaldi now for Hobart, and his shot is off the mark. It looked like he was in the crease, but pushed from behind, I believe.
It is. It's a pushing call. In the first period, Carolina really was firing the ball on the goal. They put about 11 shots up in there, and Hobart had only five shots on goal. So if you put that ball up that many times, you're going to get the ball in the goal. That's for sure.
Well, on the other side of the coin, if you have a guy in the goal like Tommy Sears, you've got to take a bunch of shots to get the number of goals you need to win.
That's true.
Now Hobart working the ball with Grimaldi behind the net.
It's a 2-3-1. They haven't shown what they're going to do yet. You get a cut. Here's a cut. Now Phil, and they look for a backside. It's not there.
And O'Hara outside the restraining line. Now inside the box. Zajdil shot. Oh, score. Hollihan low and hard past Sears. And a big goal for Hobart, one they needed.
Off the stick side, well taken. Good shot.
Jim Hollihan, number 29, comes up with the goal. Here it is again.
There he comes across. Feed coming across. And I think that play was made more by the shot than it was the play. He was open, but he just put it right where Sears couldn't get it.
He really did. He got Sears moving the other direction is what was happening. So, of course, you can't go back where you came from.
Hollihan, midfielder, a junior, 6 foot tall out of Centerport, New York, and he puts his club within three at 6-3, 12:40 left in first half action, and the face-off, and it's picked up by Hobart. That's Mike Walker.
Hobart is getting control of that thing on the face-off every time.
They need to do something to get the ball on the goal more.
Grimaldi down in the far corner for Hobart as he's being defended there by Randy Cox.
Absolutely beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
And Grimaldi with a big shot and a score. Two straight goals for Hobart, and the Statesmen are right back in it at 6-4.
Here's a classic roll dodge. There it is. Look at that. He came around the goal. The defenseman applied a little pressure on the top side, and he just ducked right underneath him and dumped it in.
Once again, Cox had bad position, and yep. You win the game with your feet, and it's amazing how a good defenseman always retains that square position, and doesn't it? In this both cases, Cox has been scored on by Grimaldi. He has committed to Grimaldi, which has allowed Grimaldi to make the play.
I think with these two offenses we're seeing today, you can never count anybody out of this game. And there's Hobart with the ball again.
And they've scored twice in a row, and they've got old Mr. Moe on their side. The momentum with Hobart. Here's Eckerson behind the goal, going 1-on-1 against Tom Haas, and he'll pull back and dish it off now to Cal Harris.
Let's go, Cal!
Here comes a 1-on-1 dodge. The problem here is that everybody tends to stand around and watch him go rather than to get into the flow of the game. There's a man.
Not a good choice of shots, and by the same token, Carl, just as you indicated, the right wing midfielder, in this case number 45, should have driven across the hole in order to clear the area to allow the man to make the play.
Exactly.
Sort of reminds me of the way the old Baltimore Bullets used to clear the side for Earl Monroe and just let him go one-on-one.
Same principle.
Seeing much the same thing right here.
Absolutely.
Grimaldi now being double-teamed, and loose ball is knocked around and is picked up by Hobart, and they score! Cal Harris, unsettled situation.
That was incredible.
I think that goal right there was created, you have your cardinal sins. Tommy Sears right there knocks the ball towards the goal, and luckily it was picked up by the Hobart man. I'm not quite sure what he was doing.
It was not a smart play by Sears to push the ball towards his goal, I gather, although I assume he was trying to put it to one of his players.
I assume somebody was behind him calling for the ball in the crease.
It was certainly an alert play on the part of Hobart, though. We'll give the credit there.
Cal Harris out of Appalachian, New York, comes up with a goal, and Hobart strikes three times very quickly, and they're within one at 6-5. We got ourselves a hell of a ball game, gentlemen.
You got it.
And he's got the face off again.
Mike Walker
has done a marvelous job for Hobart in getting the ball.
A well of a comeback, and Hobart within one at 6-5. And Malloy working behind the goal, some one-on-one movement again now against Vogel. He feeds, and a shot, and just off the mark, Eckerson did not quite have the ball secured before taking that shot, and unable to score. Now Carolina will try to clear it upfield.
Play the game!
Cox is begging for a penalty out there.
I've never seen that work a whole lot.
Now, I think Mr. Tulai's seen that before.
Yeah.
10:34 left in the second quarter. Doug Albright along with Carl Ortman and Dick Corrigan, and we're at Loyola College, Evergreen Field. Neutral site for these two championship teams, and it's been a very good first half. It's a 6-5 Carolina lead. They've got the ball. With
10 minutes to go, Carolina's brought the ball over. I think they're going to set themselves up in a one-on-one situation. Yes, they have.
And there's a man open and shot off the mark there for Vogel.
They're actually trying to get the ball into a dodging situation out front, but I don't really think they're trying to get the man out front to be able to shoot. I think they're just trying to set him up for a feed.
I think you're right.
And that time they had the whole play worked. They had the man beat, the goalie was out of goal, and the defenseman stopped it with his leg.
Here's Mike Burnett for North Carolina.
Nice cut, nice play, just an errant feed.
Vogel couldn't come up with it, and Van Aerstel has a loose ball. He works it near side to Cypher. And way across the field, his pass goes to John Edney. Now loose ball knocked around, and Hobart scoops up another ground ball.
31 is Van Aerstel, the Hobart goaltender, who made a nice place to start this off to get him out of the hole.
And now here comes Hobart, unsettled situation. They've got Holohan, and he has the ball stripped away by a defender, looked like Tom Haas, and the loose ball comes back to North Carolina with Holohan again.
has a flag down. I'm pretty sure they're going to call him for in the head. Let's see what they do with the ball, if anything.
Zajdl now for Hobart, pulls it back out, and we'll have a whistle, and we'll get an explanation.
Cross-check in the head, I believe he's calling.
Yeah, Hobart did not play that very well. When the ball was down, I don't know that 16 saw the flag or not. If he did see the flag, he certainly should have gone to move the ball towards the goal and take advantage of two chances.
Well, I think a lot of it had to do with the wind factor. Today, you can't hear much, but I know when we used to have a play like that and you couldn't really get in touch with the guy with the ball, we used to have a key word that everybody on the bench would yell that would let him know that a flag was down.
Okay.
And obviously, they don't have that.
That's right. I think I talked to him about that.
All right, we're at a 2-3-1, and it looks like North Carolina is holding to that zone. Now it's now rotating.
Now look for the man coming around the outside.
Yeah, they're going to have to get that man from behind the goal because the extra man is behind the goal.
And here's Hobart working the ball very patiently. Grimaldi now for the Statesman, and a save by Tom Sears. And Sears with a pass across midfield. And it's scooped up there by North Carolina's Burnett.
Nice play. A flag is down. Now let's see if North Carolina has some way of going to the goal or knowing about it. No, same thing.
Now, there's a slash, 1 minute penalty. Carolina's extra man team comes on the field, and Hobart comes out with the long sticks.
Guy Van Arsdale, a Division III All-American out of Geneva, New York, and has done a very good job over the years for Hobart. Van Arsdale in his senior year.
Yeah, I think as Dick said earlier, he's probably, if not number two, he's close to being the second-best goalie in the country. Then there's always Vinny Pfeiffer over at the University of Baltimore. Excellent goalie. Six men out in front of the goal. All right, here's what they're looking for is right here. They've got to get the ball back to Burnett. Burnett's got to come up a little bit, and there's the shot. And they're not going to take that one.
There's a hole being created in the Hobart defense in there at this point in time, and it appears to me as though David Wingate is quite open. They just did not seem from the midfield side.
Burnett for Carolina. He feeds it outside. Shot taken there by Vogel. And loose ball comes to Hobart.
You know, I'm not too awfully sure that when we get right down to the wire, it could be the hottest goalie is going to be the winning team. These guys are good. They make some saves you wouldn't expect a normal goalie to make.
And now here comes North Carolina again. That's Pete Vogel right at the restraining line. And his pass goes to Hohmeyer. Now Vogel shot and into the crowd. Everybody okay back there. And with North Carolina back, Mike Burnett, and they'll keep the ball.
Hohmeyer is the guy they've got to get the ball to. Right up here. Come on around, Mike, and dump it. No, wrong again.
They hit Wingate again, right on the crease. Burnett to Wingate, teaming up for another goal, and it's a 7-5 Carolina lead. Dave Wingate, the man that Hobart felt they had to stop, and he scored three times here in the first half.
Let's take a look at that again. Watch him come around. You see, I got Homer Hyde, throws it back across the crease. And once again, David Wingate pops up out of the ground.
And there's what our situation is as Carolina leads Hobart by 7-5.
What do you like here, Dick?
I don't know. This is a terrific team. Two terrific teams. And Carolina is outstanding. There's no question. They have a lot of confidence in their ability, and they play with an enormous amount of poise. Both teams are in excellent condition. It's a tough one, Carl.
Illegal procedure goes against North Carolina, and Hobart will get it in their own end.
Press is on. Nice ride. Let's see who comes up with it. This is where you find out the difference between these two clubs. When it comes down to the last whistle, it's your goalies, but it's also the team that gets the ball off the ground and puts it in their offensive end.
We've got an offside against Hobart, which gives the ball back to Carolina.
Here come the long sticks.
Little mistakes. Little mistakes.
7:04 left in our first half of action, and it's been a very good first half of play. Hobart staying with North Carolina very nicely. It's a 7-5 game. There's Tom Sears out of Calvert Hall. And on the near side to Haas.
Once again, the stick work of North Carolina really does prevent you from going into that zone. Wingate again.
Oh. Wingate with a circus shot, and it does not connect. And the race was on towards the back line, and it looks like Carolina will keep the ball. Burnett.
Ah, just lost it.
Nice move coming around. I'm afraid he stepped into the crease, gives the ball back to Hobart.
He did.
Well, unique thing about the Carolina offense, unlike many offenses today, is that they use a crease man. And Wingate is truly a crease man. He stays right in front of that goal and around the front of that goal, sets picks for the midfielders, double backs, comes back on the ball, moves to the ball. He is a crease man. And many offenses today are used more of a rotation, whereas Wingate knows his trade and does it well.
It's a zone against Hobart. Let's see how they handle it. And Arsdale's going to have to bring it this way. Now there's a man. There's a mini. He's got to hit him. Bang.
And he does. That's Zajdal for Hobart. And he's forced out of bounds. The ball goes back to North Carolina.
Hobart shifted the ball effectively on their clear. Just came up with a bad play.
The way to beat that zone is to be able to move the ball and to be able to handle the ball. And if that breaks down, you don't clear the ball. And Carolina seems to be getting the better of the two. Watch the way they handle the ball in the middle where it's very tight.
Sears way out on the clear. And he finds an open man across midfield. It's Bill Ness. Now Ness inside the restraining area, and they'll work the offense. Martel to Burnett. Burnett feeds on the crease.
Another great play by Wingate, a super pick, a great feed, and a great save.
Wingate is a circus shooter, isn't he? He comes up with the ball, and that's Wingate right there being guarded by Cypher. And now Burnett for North Carolina.
And I'll give David a chance to get back into the offense. They're not going to do anything without him in there.
Now Burnett cradling with the left hand and tries to cut across the attack zone and has the ball knocked away, and we're going to have a whistle.
They're calling it a push. It looks sort of like a hook, but it'll be 30 seconds and Carolina will be up.
One of the things that created that play was the fact that there was no backup for Hobart. There was nobody there to stop him, so therefore the defenseman is forced to use unusual circumstances.
Part of our overflow crowd here at Evergreen Field, Loyola College campus.
2-3-1. The basic premise here is they'll try to move the ball around, cut a man through. Here come the cuts. And then they'll try to fill the backside with a man.
That's vocal for Carolina. Now to Ness. And Ness outside the restraining
good pressure.
Area.
The play has to be, Burnett has to come out from behind the goal to make this work. There he is.
Ness,
now, good
shot. Knocked away, Van Aerstale in the crease, comes up with the loose ball, and they'll try to clear it upfield and kill that penalty.
Oh.
And there's a push from behind. Ball out of bounds, it's going to go to Carolina. No foul on the play.
No. Oh, he got it. Very seldom do you see this. This is a first. You see one official come up to the other who had a better eyeball on it. And he said, hey, listen, that wasn't a hit. It was legal. It was a push.
4:46 left in the first half of play. Carolina leads Hobart 7-5. And we'll be back with more lacrosse action.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus. The dream, a reality. The illusion, a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now, and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck in stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
We went over the figures, and I found out I was saving thousands of dollars.
When I went to purchase my dream car, a Datsun 280ZX, I shopped the Baltimore, Washington area, and I found my best deal here at Town & Country Datsun.
When you say it starts saving $900 to $1,000 on a deal, something like that, I mean, you're pretty good.
The deal was really good.
Town & Country Pontiac Datsun, located 2 miles north of Beltway Exit 32. If it's not a Town & Country deal, it's not your best deal.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
Carolina, or Hobart rather, with the ball as they trail by 1-7-5, and an opportunity to get within one goal here.
Nice check.
Hobart man was checked into the crease, giving possession to Carolina. Let's see if Hobart changes this ride at all.
I think they're going to have to if they expect to pick up any goals on the ride. I think Carolina's just too good with the stick to be able to let them come up the field this far.
4:28 left in second quarter action, a 7-5 ball game. North Carolina with the ball and the lead. And Hobart really making the best of their opportunities here in the first half.
Nice play.
Now Hobart gets it across midfield. John Haas, and now working inside, or just outside the restraining area, that's Rice, as he makes a move on Martin.
Hobart brings those long sticks in, and all of a sudden they get super aggressive on you.
There's a pass there for Martel for Carolina, and he'll bring it back outside and set up the offense with Danko.
Well, I think I was wishing. That was a wish pass.
Well, Coach, how do you like that pass from the hip?
Oh, I'd have loved that one. I'd have loved that one. That's how I touched why I turned gray and decided to go into business. There's too many guys who fed the ball like that.
We used to call it the champ or chump play.
Which was it, more champ or more chump?
Well, unfortunately, most of the time it was more chump.
There we go. Carolina's moving.
See, here's the difference. You got a broken play here. Watch Carolina go into their routine. Thank you.
Oh, Wingate was open on the crease, and looks like he's pushed from behind as he was unable to connect.
Mac, they blew it. I think they blew it. I really do. I think Mac Ford should have taken the shot. There was no need for the third pass wasn't necessary.
Well, you know, they've gone through it so many times. They've made those same two passes. You get a broken situation. You get a guy on the crease. They just go to the offside naturally because the guy's always there. In that case, it just didn't go for him. I think we'll see it again before the game's over.
I'm sure we're going to, Carl, the way these guys move.
Nice ride from Carolina as Hobart now clears it across midfield. And loose ball is going to be scooped up there by North Carolina's John Haas. And he fires it across midfield over the head of Mac Ford. And the ball goes out of bounds on the far side.
I don't know whether you all noticed that or not, but that was number 27. That was our goalkeeper, Sears, out there playing the ball up in the restraining line area.
Tommy is a very aggressive ball player coming out of that goal. And as you can see, it burned him once today, but most of the time he gets away with it. He's good enough.
He's sure a fine athlete.
Here's that tight end stick work we're talking about in order to be able to clear the ball. They got away with it this time.
Malvi for Hobart.
Now it looks as though Hobart's going into a high post.
There he is again, right over the head.
And Grimaldi has it taken away, and Carolina coming the other way. Seivold across midfield, and he looks for and finds his man. That's Mac Ford. Ford feeds on the crease. It's knocked away, and loose ball run down on the far side of the field, and it goes out of bounds.
Looks to me as though Randy Cox has decided he's not going to get beaten by Mr. Grimaldi anymore.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think after about two or three times, you decide that that's it. One of the things about a team like Carolina, who is so good in the broken situation, they tend to overpass, as you said before, but they also tend to force.
Mm-hmm.
Nice clear.
This is a good clear.
Across midfield, Grimaldi, his pass, he finds a man open in Zajdal, and it's knocked away momentarily. And now here comes Holohan for Hobart. Holohan working on...
Here comes a double.
Cox, and the ball knocked away, race on toward the
that's a
baseline.
Push.
Nice try now.
That's a push.
That's...
And the ball will go to Hobart, I believe.
That is correct. And we had a little push there on the part of the Carolina goalie.
I think the ball was already out of bounds, and of course the closest man to the ball gets it, so I don't think they called it for that reason. It's a one-on-one. I'm very surprised at Hobart. There's a nice play.
Grimaldi with a good feed, and he ends up with the ball again. His
nice
shot.
Save.
And Sears comes up with a save, although it looked like it was off the mark. And now a good pass across midfield. It's Cox.
Excellent pass.
To Burnett. Burnett
Two teams, a lot of credit here. Great credit for Carolina on the break, and then the defensive move by Hobart, which was just sensational.
There's a break.
And we're back the other way again.
Here we'll see it. 4-on-3. Classic 4-on-3. Point, front side, back side, no. Nice defense.
Tom Grimaldi for Hobart, and it's a 7-6 game. Hobart just keeps coming back.
And that play was over. There was no 4-on-3.
Here it is. You are right.
Bang. He was going away from the goal, and on a second thought, he decided, why not? Let's go for it.
He went right back on the inside pipe, too, which I think that's a sophisticated shooter.
Very nice play. 7-6.
And maybe Carolina a little bit surprised by the game they're getting from Hobart here in the first half.
I think so. That little exchange a few seconds ago was really fascinating. The two fast breaks on both ends of the field, it was good.
You know, it looked like Carolina had gotten back on that fast break, too. It looked like the unsettled situation had sort of died down for Hobart, and all of a sudden Grimaldi pumps it in when it looked like Hobart was finally getting back on defense.
I think they had the 4-on-3 stopped, and they just decided they weren't going to let them stop them.
1:02 left, first half, 7-6 to score, and we'll be back.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus. The dream, a reality. The illusion, a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck, in stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
Oh, I know I saved a tremendous amount of money. I saved over $1,000 on my deal on the Pulsar. And I don't think I would have gotten that anywhere else but Town and Country.
Town and Country, I think I saved about $1,000.
I saved $1,800 on my Town and Country deal.
Well, I got $2,702 off my card.
I figured I saved about $1,200.
Town and Country Pontiac Dodson, located 2 miles north of Beltway Exit 32. If it's not a Town and Country deal, it's not your best deal.
The Hobart Statesmen keep battling back, and they're within one off that last goal from Grimaldi. It's a 7-6 game, a minute, 2 seconds left in first half action.
We have a little Grimaldi versus Wingate out here. Each of them has 3 goals, I believe.
And once again, the ball goes to Hobart. They are playing a fired up first half. And here's Grimaldi for Hobart. Now works the ball outside to Malloy. Back outside the restraining area, Walker, now Zajdal.
Carl, would you tell him to hold it for one shot?
Yeah, I don't think so. I think we got an extra man play here. And I think they're going to go right to the hole. You had a minute penalty and you got a minute left in the quarter. I think you got to let them shoot right towards the end of it.
Okay.
And we've got 25 seconds left in the first half, and Hobart being patient. And even if they don't score, they've got to be quite content that being down by one.
They may go back in that huddle and reevaluate.
Look, Hobart's going back into the huddle now and trying to determine exactly what they should do with these last 18 seconds. It appears to me that they're going to set themselves up for an outside shot. Carl?
I think what they will probably do is they'll go in for that last shot right before the half. What you'll see is you'll see one or two passes, and then they'll have the quick pass behind the goal, a cut, and then you'll see them get it to the man who's going to finally make the feed. And it's going to be a shot from the backside, so just look for that backside. If you want a key on this particular last 18 seconds, it's going to be how Hobart carries it off versus the pride of North Carolina to stop it. If Carolina stops this play, you look for the momentum second half to begin with Carolina. If Hobart can put the ball on the goal, look for Hobart to come out swinging in the second half. So this is a big 18 seconds.
Those tough kids from upper New York State are going to go after this one, I believe. They're going to go after it big.
We keep saying that Hobart is surprising Carolina here in the first half and that they've got to be very happy with their play, but I'm sure they figured that, you know, they were going to be in this game from start to finish. And if you ask them, they'd say, well, you know, we figured it to be this way.
I'm sure of that. Well, they've got a great history of lacrosse up there. It goes back a long time. So they have to take a back seat to anybody.
Okay, here comes the ball. He's going to force his way around. Now watch for the clear out.
And we've got 9 seconds left, and they're not inside the restraining area. The pass is thrown out of bounds as Holahan trying to get it to Malloy and threw it way out of bounds. So 5 seconds left, and Carolina will get an opportunity.
Holahan just jumped too quickly. I think he got...
Well, they had a play, and they had a place they had to be, and he was going to get it there regardless. And I think his man moved on him. If I knew Tommy Sears here to stand there, yeah.
They'll hold the ball, and that's the end of the first half of play. A good first half. It's North Carolina 7, Hobart 6, and we'll have halftime festivities after these messages.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
In the dark about buying a new car...
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
Hi, I'm Dick Corrigan here with Tom O'Connor, Athletic Director of Loyola College. Tommy, you've jumped out of Division III into Division I. You're building some new facilities. Can you tell us about it?
Well, it's a very exciting time for us on campus, going to Division I naturally. But more importantly, we're building some new facilities, indoor facilities. You can see behind us, we're standing on our AstroTurf, which we're extremely proud of. But our new facilities is a complete college center. We'll have three components, a fine arts center, an athletic center, and a student center. And we're really excited about what it's going to do to the quality of student life.
Oh, well, you'll affect the entire student life, not just your athletic program.
No, it's going to have these three components to it, but obviously I'm most excited about the athletic part, which will have a 3,000-seat basketball arena, an Olympic-sized pool, some racquetball, squash courts, and all the nice things that go along with that.
Right. Well, it certainly is a beautiful facility, and this athletic facility that I've seen today is absolutely marvelous, and we certainly enjoyed being here with you today. And we want to thank you very much for coming on and talking to us.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus, the dream a reality, the illusion a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you. Hi, Len Stoller inviting you to our Getting to Know You sale with Ford, Chrysler, Plymouth, Porsche, and Audi all under one roof. I want to get to know you by saving you money on our fantastic selection of over 500 cars and trucks. Right now and for a limited time, I'll sell you any 83 car, truck in stock for just $1 over factory invoice. That's all, $1 over factory invoice. Get to know us at Len Stoller, your one-stop car shop, 5 miles north of Beltway Exit 20 on Reisterstown Road.
At halftime, a fairly even score, 7-6 in favor of Carolina, and the statistics show that we've got a pretty close ball game.
Stats are interesting. You got faceoffs here. You got Hobart with 11 faceoffs, North Carolina only 4. And then again, on the shot side of the thing, you've got Hobart taking 14 shots and Carolina taking 21 shots.
You know, that face-off figure can be deceiving. Out of that 11, you give a guy a face-off when he comes up with the ball initially, but you still count it even if he loses a ball after 3 steps. And I think that's what happened to a lot of them in the first quarter there. They came up with it and then turned it over.
That's right. They sure did. Carolina plays a good unit defense, and both teams play good unit defense. As a matter of fact, both these teams are outstanding lacrosse teams, and I'm just pleased that we're here to be able to bring the game to y'all.
Question is, can Hobart stay with Carolina here in the second half, or will North Carolina wear them down? You get deep on the rosters, and maybe the second and third player down at each position for Carolina has a little bit more talent than the Carolina players.
Here we are, the Battle of Champions, Hobart College versus North Carolina. A great ball game we've got here. Can they stay, we ask ourselves? Can Hobart stay with Carolina?
I think so. I think they can. I don't see any reason why not. The only difference would be if Carolina decided to put it in overdrive. Then you might see a change in this ball game. Right now, Carolina's been hanging in this ball game on sheer skill. They haven't done anything miraculous. They've taken the broken situations. They've thrown the ball in the goal when they had to. They've scored when they had to. But they really haven't gone into gear yet.
Well, is it possible for Carolina to wear Hobart down, or do you think that Hobart physically can stay with them?
It appears to me that they're playing, they're matching players up one-to-one. I don't think that Carolina is playing any more people in this game than Hobart is. I don't think they're using their bench that much more.
I think you're right, Dick. I see the same players out there.
And we're underway here in the third quarter. Doug Albright with Carl Ortman and Dick Corrigan. And it's third quarter action. North Carolina with the ball, wearing the blue and white and black uniforms. And they're going from our left to our right as they take on the Statesmen of Hobart. Carolina leads 7-6.
Notice they pulled that zone up a little bit tighter this half. They're not going to sit back the way they did in the first half. They could get burned this way, too, like that.
And Carolina gets it into the offensive end for the first time. That's John Haas. And the ball scooped there to Van Aerstel, and Hobart will clear it upfield looking for that tying goal.
Oh,
almost over the head of Van Aerstel.
It's a good thing he has a long stick.
Nice try.
Nice attempt there by North Carolina's Hohmeyer, but he couldn't come up with the ball, and now Hobart as Malloy brings the ball into play for the Statesman.
It looks like a one-on-one dodge. They're in a 1-4-1. Here it comes.
Just inside the restraining area, Malloy, he finds a man.
Oh,
shot.
Nice save.
Off the mark by Eckerson as a Sears comes up with a good save. And now Carolina tries to clear it upfield.
Hobart is all around that ball.
It's Malloy for the Statesman, and he'll pull back a little bit. There's a feed. Feed on the crease, and the ball knocked away as they tried to get it to Malvey. And loose ball comes again to Tom Sears.
Oh, nice look, but I think he got offsides coming there, yeah.
Yeah, he sure did.
Yeah, John Edney offsides for Hobart.
Hobart has come out running. They had decided they're going to go to their press and push game, and it seems to be working so far.
I think we might see some bodies flying around a little while, too.
What a great way to start the season for Hobart if they could knock off a team that's won 26 straight.
Oh boy, I'll say.
Well, I don't think Hobart wants to get too far out in front. I mean, remember, they're a Division III team, right?
That's right.
That'd be a heck of a recruiting tool, too. We knocked off a team that's won 26 straight, but of course that hasn't happened yet. They trail by one. Carolina.
Nice ball.
Martel, his shot. No.
Super fake. Of course, once again, Hobart goes back a long way in lacrosse. Babe Krause, Bill Stiles. And now they have the athletic director up there, Mike Hanna, who was an old, who was the coach at Princeton. So they, lacrosse is a big part of their program.
And they try to work the clear. That's Cypher, number 41. He fires it way across the field now to Dan Whalen.
There we go.
Here comes Wingate. And
nice save
by Van Aerstel. Nicely done. Vogel shoots.
Another save.
And he comes up with another save. Van Aerstel, nice job.
That was fantastic.
Now, Hobart on the other end. And a ball knocked away by Hollihan. And now here comes North Carolina back up the other way. It's Rice.
Oh!
And ball's going to go out of bounds.
Hobart is playing like crazy. That series of saves just a few minutes ago by Van Aerstel were just fantastic. He had two of the best players in the country. You've got Vogel and Wingate both firing on him, and the guy comes up with a big save. It's got to lift this team.
I tell you, the coaches probably aren't very excited about this, but from a spectator's point, it's great lacrosse to watch.
You betcha.
12 minutes left in third quarter action, a 7-6 game. That's where we were at the half. And Hobart with a chance to tie it up right now. That's Grimaldi, and he was the first half offensive star for the Statesman. Has the ball stripped away, and Sears comes up with a loose ball.
Oh, my heavens.
Now here comes Carolina back
play.
The other side, Rice. And he gets the ball now to Martel. Burnett, North Carolina leads by one.
Right
and
down.
There's a flag. Now Burnett will keep the offensive action rolling. Martel for Carolina. He'll shoot, and it's off the mark.
It's a slash, 1 minute, and Carolina will be up for that minute. This could be a big goal. This, we've been into about 4 minutes into this half so far, and we don't have any score yet. First score in this half could be a big one. It could tie it on one hand, or it could open up a two-goal lead on the other. So this is an important goal for both teams.
Which is probably why those two saves by Van Aerstel earlier were so important. Kept his team within one. And here comes Vogel now for North Carolina. They work it around the perimeter. Ness.
2-3-1.
Burnett.
You'll see a cut coming in a minute. There's the cut. Now they get itself into a 2-1-4-1. A shot goal, nice.
Hard shot. Jeff Hohmeyer out of Mineola, New York. His second goal of the game. And North Carolina back on top by two at 8-6. 10:57 left in the third quarter. Big goal for Hohmeyer.
In the second quarter, we were saying that the idea was for them to bring the ball around the side of the goal for Burnett, dump it off to Hohmeyer, and take a shot. We're going to see it right now. Here comes Burnett with the ball. He's going to come around that goal, dunk it off, and bang. That's what we were saying in the first half is what he should have been doing the whole time. And there was a perfect execution of that play.
Sure was, Carl. He must have an awfully hard shot.
And just another example of the fine talent that we've got here today as Hohmeyer puts his club up by two. And now here comes Hobart back on the attack. It's Malloy, and he gets it to Grimaldi, trying to work on the crease, knocked down.
Grimaldi is incredible.
Good move.
Grimaldi was tripped, knocked down in the back, ran on his knees two steps, got up and came around, took a shot.
They got a push, 30-second penalty, and now Hobart has a chance to get back in the ballgame.
All the pregame talk about Wingate for Carolina, but Grimaldi showed us some moves on the offensive end for Hobart so far today.
Yeah, he sure has. He is not intimidated.
So now Hobart.
Hobart sets up in a 2-3-1. The two middies out front, three across the crease, one behind. Move the ball around the horn. And in a minute, you'll see him cut into a play.
On, Johnny!
Grimaldi looks to feed, gets it outside, and that's O'Hara.
There's the cut. Now you see the backside, and they're going to try the next pass. Should be the shot. And
Malloy.
He's covered. Nice play.
Good defense there from Tom Hawes. He was
excellent
right with
Grimaldi. Excellent defense by Hawes. Excellent defense.
Feed on the
crease.
Oh,
nice play.
And O'Hara couldn't handle the pass. Now O'Hara comes up with a loose ball outside the box.
It's all even. And here comes a shot.
Oh, you bet! What a beauty! I think he tore the net, Bo.
Well, he did let that one rip.
Zastel with the high five says he's put his club within one again at 8-7. They just keep on answering one another.
Watch
here
it is. Watch his shot. And it's bang. Thank you. I think he just wanted to make an impression on that one. He just went after that goal and said, I'm going to throw this one in.
High fives on the sideline as Hobart realizes they've got an opportunity to come up with a big win here. Every time Carolina seems to gain an advantage, the Statesmen come right back. And we've got exactly 10 minutes left in the third quarter. It's a one-goal game once again. 8-7, Carolina leads.
Hey, boy.
Now the face-off. It's Smith.
That foul right there was for kicking the other man's stick. You are not allowed to kick the other man's stick as you're facing off. You can kick through the ball, but you can't kick his stick. So, therefore, Hobart comes up with it.
And Hobart with a chance to tie the score. Grimaldi behind the nets. He works against Cox.
Working a lot of picks out in front now. They're rotating the offense. It's basically a 2-2-2, and it comes into a 2-3-1.
And now they should be clearing out for this man. They've got their middies high, but every time he gets to the point of the goal where he could be making that turn, they're in the way.
Haas with some good defense on Morfitt, and that ball will go out of bounds. It goes to North Carolina.
I guess I'm getting to be an old man, Carl, but I look at that defense out there, and I think he's fouling him all the time.
Well, I'll be honest with you. In the last couple years, they're letting him get it away with more and more and more. And as long as the guy's still got his arms intact, they're not going to do much. The other point to realize is when we were taking those things, they were wooden, and they made a lifelong impression on you. Now this plastic doesn't hurt as much.
I suppose that's right. Of course, they get used to it.
Vogel's pass for Wingate is knocked away, and Van Arsdale comes up with a loose ball for Hobart. And Hobart really showing its stuff here in the third quarter. They're down by one at 8-7, 8:52 left in third quarter action. Pass way across midfield. And there for Hobart is Cal Harris.
John Hawes got caught napping on that one. That's one thing you don't want to have. You want that attackman to sneak up and give him the easy clear, but he was right open there. And so John's got to be on his toes.
Malloy going one-on-one. The pass, the shot.
Oh, another nice play.
Looked momentarily like Hobart may have tied it up, but the shot just off the mark, and Hobart was back. They'll maintain possession. Here's Grimaldi. Cradles with the right hand as he works on Haas. And
Grimaldi was there looking.
Intercepted.
Grimaldi was there looking for a foul. He got hit in the head, and I think he took his eye off the ball.
And now loose ball, and the ball comes to Hobart, Van Arsdale, and Hobart sets up the clear.
Dick, who's the winner in a running game between these two teams?
Oh, I think Carolina.
I tend to agree with you. I'm a little bit surprised that we're seeing so much of that out of Hobart when you consider the percentage of the time that Carolina scores when they get a broken situation.
Yeah, exactly. And I think when you look over at that bench, there are 40-some 40-some boys over there on that bench.
I know.
And I haven't played a whole lot of them yet. And if it gets really running, you could have some problems.
Carolina, again with the ball. Tom Sears, their All-American goalie. Works it up slowly as they check the ride from Hobart and get ready to try to clear it across midfield.
See, they pulled that ride up about 15 yards. Now they drop back, but they're not going to let them get as far upfield this half. Now let's see what they do.
Across midfield, that's Ness for North Carolina. And Bill Ness being guarded there by Elliott, and Ness has it knocked away but comes up with a loose ball. And now over to Brian Rice. Rice just inside the restraining line. He's being guarded there closely by Tim Clark. The shot from Ness off the mark. Van Aerstel comes up with the loose ball, and he clears it now to Dan Whalen. Here comes Whalen. He finds a man in the person of Cal Harris. And Hobart with the ball, a chance to tie, 7:03 left in the third quarter.
Now, Hobart's got to be able to go into an offensive pattern. They've got to be able to move the ball and get it to an open man. They cannot afford to go one-on-one this game and expect to win.
That's Hollahan. O'Hara now.
They're still playing a straight man-to-man. They're in a 2-2-2. And a very nice play,
Hobart
passed into the crease and a nice shot.
Hobart seems to use that one-on-one almost as a disguise to their offense.
Yeah.
They look like they're in a one-on-one, and all they're trying to do is draw somebody and flip off.
Zajdal, the man who took that shot for Hobart that was just off the mark. And that's twice Hobart has nearly tied up this game at 8. Now Grimaldi working against Tom Haas, and his feet on the crease, and
save.
Sears with a nice save.
A great save. I note that Carolina has taken Randy Cox off of Grimaldi and put Tom Haas on him.
Now here comes Carolina down at the other end. Brian Rice,
nice check.
Van Aerstel picks up the loose ball.
It is a genuine, oh my heavens.
Hobart with an opportunity here and unable to pick up the ball is Eckerson. And here we come the other way.
Oh, how fast these two teams do move that ball.
And a bit sloppy at this point.
Yeah.
And it's going to go out of bounds back to Hobart. And the further we get into this second half of action, I think Hobart gaining more and more confidence. They realize they can really play with Carolina.
That's for sure.
Now the clearing pass.
That might be the longest pass I've ever seen in a lacrosse game. Certainly the longest one everybody ever caught.
Come up with that ball.
And loose ball is picked up there by North Carolina's side ball.
Got a slash.
And we're going to have a slash, I believe, called against Hobart. And that's Eckerson contesting the call.
It's going to be a one-minute foul, much as he protests. I've never seen it reversed.
And that doesn't help much.
So we're going to have an extra man situation. Once again, the pattern seems to be that Carolina goes up by 2, and Hobart comes back the next play. So this may be the chance that Carolina is looking for to get up by 2 again. All 6 men are up in front of the goal.
And here comes that North Carolina offense, 5:33 left third quarter. Carolina by 1. They've got an extra man situation.
All 6 men are out in front of the goal again. They're looking for the man inside. He's got to get the ball across to the other man. There he is. Now he can look inside. Somebody's got to be open in those seams. There he is. Oh.
They tried to get it into Wingate, and it was knocked away. And loose ball now comes to Hobart.
I think it was one pass too many.
Trying to find the seams, and they thought they had it in the seam, but it wasn't there.
Yeah.
And here comes Hobart across midfield. This is Cal Harris.
Haas has again given up the ball to that attackman.
Teams are all even again. Nice play. Oh, my. Good defensive maneuver by John Haas.
And here's,
over the head again.
Here's Sears out of the net, and he has it knocked away but gets the ball over now to North Carolina's Bill Ness. Ness fires it all the way across the field to Vogel, and Vogel gets it across midfield into the offensive end for Carolina. They lead by 1, 4.5 minutes left in the third quarter. Good move by Ness to get away from 2 defenders, and loose ball. And And here comes North Carolina with Burnett.
Look for the broken play in the backside feed.
Wingate. Now the hard kick and a score. Big goal for Bill Ness, the midfielder out of Moncton, Maryland. And that puts North Carolina up again by two at 9-7.
Broken play again.
Now here's a situation where Carolina knows exactly where to look. Here's a ball picked up over Ness, bang, it's in the goal. He even could have kept the ball coming over to Holmeyer, who was also sitting on the other side with him.
It's a 9-7 lead, and facing off now for North Carolina is Ward Stidell. And handling the chores will be Mike Walker for Hobart, and Walker comes up with the faceoff.
Walker is an amazing faceoff man. He's gotten the first shot at the ball almost every time on these faceoffs today.
Uniquely, his style is such that being a little guy, you wouldn't think he'd do it that way. Most big guys usually get away with clamping the ball down, drawing it out. He's a little guy, must have awfully quick hands.
And Hobart now down by two. Every time they get within one, Carolina answers back. And Hobart a chance to close that lead again. It's a 9-7 game, 3:40 left in the third quarter. Doug Albright with Carl Ortman and Dick Carrigan. Hope you're enjoying lacrosse action between North Carolina and Hobart. Hobart with the ball.
Hobart's got to be careful right now. That they are that two goal down right now. They've got to come up with a goal here, or else Carolina could make it three, and then they could be in trouble again. But remember, both of them score in spurts at any one time.
Here's Don Malloy going against his man Cox, and the pass in the attack area is knocked away.
Another great save, which saved Carolina from a lot of trouble, a lot of pain.
Here we go. Oh, nice check.
Fierce checking, and loose ball is going to be picked up there by Carolina's Randy Cox. Now being pressured in the corner, Cox comes out with it, and he gets it back now to Tom Sears.
Talk about pinpoint passing. Yes.
Now Stidell.
Here's a broke play. Watch the back. Oh,
Burnett. And Van Aerstel with the save.
That is a beautiful play. A great outlet pass and a flip over. There's your fast break. Onto the corner. There's a shot.
Oh, nice.
Great save. Another great save by Sears.
Sears made an awesome save, turned around, had another save, and the ball trickles in the goal. Watch this. This is incredible. We'll explain this. Here comes a play. Nice save. The ball's up. They try to contain it, and the defenseman actually knocks the ball in the goal. It looked like it didn't go over the line, but it did.
Of course, the rules of the game say the entire ball's got to cross the line, so from our vantage point up here, I guess it did.
Sure, or else he wouldn't have called it a goal.
That's exactly right. Officials don't do things like that.
And once again, Hobart has answered back as they continue to exchange goals, and now Hobart with the faceoff chores by Catalano, and they come up with the loose ball. This is Sweely.
They do it every time. They have really solved the Carolina faceoff situation. They just get all these faceoffs.
I think this is the first time we've seen this midfield for Hobart in the game. Their ball players maybe are getting tired.
Yeah, could be. Could well be.
And they trail by just one. 9-8, 1:50
nice
left.
That was a terrific check. And Hobart retains possession behind the goal. Hobart's changing their midfields back. They're going back in now to their, as their starting group.
Now Hobart likes to get into this cluster move on the crease and then roll off the picks. He's there, but that's a force.
Oh, amazing. That was a beautiful play. Another great play. How about that, Bob?
Well, that's an incredible play. And we'll watch that again. Watch the way that this play develops. He starts all the way over. Well, that's a little bit late now. He starts on the absolute opposite side of that pile and rolls around, picks up the feed with a man on him, then rolls back inside and looks low and shoots low and it still goes. Oh, awesome play.
Anyway, what it reminds me of a lot, Carl, is years ago down at the Naval Academy, we used to have a play like that and call it the I formation. And we had a little guy named Jimmy Lewis who scored a few goals in his life.
He
would come rolling around on that side. So it's the same kind of thing. Very well done.
And in our battle of champions, Hobart has finally battled back to tie. It's 9-9, 1:43 left in the third quarter. And don't go away, this lacrosse game up for grabs. And this faceoff is going to be handled by North Carolina. And there's another fierce check knocked to the ground is Vogel. Here comes Hobart again, a chance to take the lead for the first time.
They're getting physical out there now. And I think one team's going to try and assert themselves over the other at this particular time.
Absolutely. I also have a feeling they're going to play around with the ball a little bit now.
And that Hobart clan had made the trip down from New York into the ball game now, chanting, "Here we go, Hobart," looking for the big upset. A minute four left, third quarter. We're tied at nine, and here comes North Carolina looking to assert themselves once again. It's Hohmeyer.
Yeah, not a bad idea. In the last couple of minutes, the racehorse game has not been in Carolina's favor.
It's interesting because what Carolina's doing now is what I thought Hobart was going to do just a minute ago with only a minute to play.
Right.
So it looks like Carolina's going to play for that last shot for the third period.
Andy Smith
finds play.
Oh, I think it hit pipe.
Wingate had the shot, and it hit the near pipe just off the mark. And that ball goes out of bounds.
Now, to me, and I'm sure it has to do with the fact that we're about 100 yards away, that looked like a pretty good push in the back.
That also looked like a cross check.
Yeah.
I hate to second guess anybody, but they're there and we're not. So,
according to the official, it was neither, and North Carolina will bring it into play. Burnett down in the far corner. 26 ticks left here in third quarter action. We're tied at nine.
It's an I formation on the crease. So I guess they're going to try and let Michael go. Oops.
Burnett had it stripped away, and now we've got a whistle.
Well, it sounds like it looks like he touched the ball with his hand. Illegal
use of the hand, yeah.
So don't throw the ball over the Hobart.
Not seen very often, but there it was.
And with 19 seconds left in the third quarter, Hobart has the ball. Maybe one last shot at going ahead before the third quarter ends.
I would be very surprised if they come up with a quality shot here.
Whalen, Van Aerstel has
no
it knocked
foul.
Down.
So whoever comes up with the ball here will continue. Okay.
Oh, there we got a fast break.
Did not work.
That's the end of the third quarter play. We've got a great fourth quarter coming up. We're tied. North Carolina 9, Hobart 9. We'll be right back.
Mr. Nobody here at Town & Country Pontiac with All-Pro John Unitas.
Speaking of All-Pro, this has to be your All-Pro transportation. And I understand there's a $5,000 cash rebate right now on these StarCraft vans.
That's right, John. $5,000 cash rebate on any StarCraft van in stock. And look how they're equipped.
Do they all have captain chairs and tables and real teak wood?
Yes, but best of all, the $5,000 cash rebate that can be used as your down payment.
StarCraft custom vans and $5,000 cash rebates.
Town & Country Pontiac.
Thinking of a new car or truck? Consider leasing. Allstate leases all make and model American cars and imports. Leasing the new car or truck of your choice costs no more and probably less than you expect. Allstate's full-service lease will pamper you. It includes all maintenance, all repairs, tires, and free loaner car. At Allstate Leasing, 9808 Reisterstown Road. Phone 363-6500. In Washington, phone 948-1700.
In the dark about buying a new car.
Heritage Chevrolet has a great money-saving idea. This month, Heritage is offering 83 Chevy cars and trucks for only $50 over factory invoice. That's $50 over invoice, including dealer prep. Included are Citation, Chevettes, Cavaliers, Celebrities, Camaros, Caprices, Malibus, pickups, and vans. Options included at dealer cost. Order your new Chevrolet today at Heritage Chevrolet on Reisterstown Road, 4 miles north of Beltway Exit 20.
It began 3 short years ago as a vision, a dream, an illusion. The vision is in focus. The dream, a reality. The illusion, a fact. ESPN makes sports magic.
For advertising opportunities, call 597-8110.
Here we go, gentlemen. 15 minutes of action left. We're tied at 9. The Battle of Champions is everything it was built up to be. Hobart and North Carolina.
And Carolina has changed their faceoff man. They put in Andy Smith to face off. They've been trying to get control of the ball, and they can't do it, so they're trying a new man.
And he's facing off against Catalano.
He's going to get it. Son of a gun, if they don't come up with it again.
Remarkable job on the faceoffs done by Hobart. They've got the ball. We're tied at 9. And that's Grimaldi working with the left hand. Now brings it back outside, and a bad pass intended there for Billy Kerr.
There's a penalty. I think he stepped on the line.
Was he stepped on it or was he pushed? It is the toughest call in the world, and they're giving the ball to...
I think he signaled the wrong way, yeah. Yeah, they're going to give the ball over
to Carolina.
Carolina's got a pride factor in this thing right now. They know they're on the line. They've got to come up with the play right here, the goals, to make this thing a real win for them.
And every opportunity, a very important one. North Carolina now with Hohmeyer, far side of the field. That's to Mac Ford. Ford works behind the goal, and the defensive intensity picks up Whalen.
He forced that ball in there. I don't know what he was looking at, but there was nothing there for him to throw into.
I think he was throwing to Wingate, who was going to fade away from that double screen that was there to catch the ball. Not necessarily a smart pass, but I guess it's what you don't expect.
Good defense by Hobart as they come up with a loose ball with Dan Whalen. And his pass now down into the far corner. And he finds a man down there, John
Seifer. Look at this.
And a long pass down the field. And
can you believe that?
He almost completed it.
Almost end to end.
And again, some vicious hitting, some good checks down there on the far side. And the ball is going to go back to North Carolina.
That was a push on Hobart. Carolina will take possession. Dick, I don't know what you're seeing down here in the offensive end for Carolina, but I'm not seeing any ball movement.
No, I'm not seeing any ball movement at all. I'm surprised at them at this moment.
We had a 7-6 halftime score, and Hobart outscored North Carolina in third quarter action, 3-2. And that's where we stand at 9-9 with 13:22 left in the game. Inside pass.
There you go.
Over the head of Bill Ness.
You know, sometimes in the early going, in the early season, when the teams do get, things do get tight, you turn to one guy and ask him to do it for you. And, you know, maybe that's what they're doing indirectly. I don't think that's exactly what Coach Scruggs has in mind.
I'm sure he doesn't want him to go to that right now. I think he'd rather see the whole team get in the ballgame.
Mike Walker for Hobart. He works it now to Morfitt. Behind the goal, that's Grimaldi, an offensive star in the first half.
That's
and
a hold right there.
Really checked,
yeah.
And we're going to have a hold.
Flag down.
And pass on the crease is knocked away, and we're going to have a hold against North Carolina.
Hall's just wrapped his stick around him and said, you're not going to get inside of me, and I'll take the penalty, but I'm not giving you the goal. So now they're going to make Hobart earn the goal with an extra man situation. Big play here once again. Carolina has to hold them in this situation. I don't think they want to get down.
Absolutely not. They don't want to get down because of the face-off situation.
Exactly. They don't get the ball back. Okay, all six men once again are out in front of the goal.
They work it around. The ball now goes to Holahan.
Now he'll walk down and bring it to a wing. Now from this position where the ball is, they'll try to find the seams. They'll get to a wing here. They're not finding the seams. They've got to get more penetration on it. Okay, now we have a man behind the goal. And 1-4-1.
There's O'Hara. Pass on the crease.
A beautiful pass and a beautiful shot. Very nice play.
Eckerson open in the hole there, unable to hit as he fired it over the crossbar. Grimaldi was back. Hobart keeps the ball. 12:28 left. We're tied at 9.
Tough to convert.
And they eat up that entire 30 seconds on that play without getting a shot off. Yeah.
lead, and now Grimaldi brings it into play for Hobart.
Grimaldi is an integral part of this team right here. Without him, I'm not sure where they'd be right now.
Has it knocked away by Randy Cox, and loose ball goes to North Carolina. It's Billy Ness. He has it stripped away. Hobart with the ball. Morphin.
They are a very tenacious bunch. They are really tenacious. He's got a shot on him. He's got a shot.
Back outside.
Oh, what a face dodge. Oh, what a play. A beautiful face dodge.
Pat O'Hara.
Fabulous play.
Pat O'Hara, the junior, puts Hobart up by 10-9. Their first lead.
Right here. Bang. And he's inside. In the goal. Beautiful play.
There's a transfer student that I'm sure... the coach is happy about.
Looked like he had the shot out another 15 feet out. He made that extra move.
Oh, yeah.
Himself wide open. Hobart with their first lead at 10-9 with 11:57 left.
For any of the old-timers watching, they might remember a guy named Ray Green who played at Johns Hopkins. He used to do that every now and then. Fake the shot, give the face dodge, and go in and get another one.
Were we born yet, Dick? Were we born yet?
I wasn't, but my father told me about Mr. Green.
The action, fast and furious. Hobart with another face-off, and it's out of bounds. Malloy couldn't come up with it. North Carolina gets it going the other way. Not too often Carolina finds themselves down in the fourth quarter.
It'd be interesting to find out when the last time was they were ever losing a ball game, but it's late in the game.
We've got an injury on the far side over there.
It's one of the Hobart players, I believe.
Yeah, it looks like it's Mike Walker.
It's amazing that we've seen 3.5 quarters of really solid ball, and this is actually the first injury we've even seen come close.
That's correct. This is a tough injury if it's a lasting one for Hobart, because Walker's been getting most of their faceoffs. But he's up.
And that's good to see. He's moving off the field on his own power.
It's Mike Miller. In fact, that's their faceoff man.
So he's apparently going to be all right, and that's good news. And we're back to action. And what action we've had. North Carolina down 10-9, 11:47 left. And they'll try to clear it into their attack end.
Oh, got away with that one. Nice ball.
Head.
Still. Hobart is tenacious.
This is Burnett for North Carolina, being guarded there by Cypher. Good defense. Now Burnett open.
Somebody's got to be open. He's not throwing the ball.
He's got to be saying, where are they coming from?
That's right.
Here comes a shot.
Here comes a shot, and we got a whistle.
Where players make a great mistake is when they're in the jam like that, throw the ball not to the guy who's going to score a goal, but to the first guy you see that's open. Because the first guy that's open, he'll know where everybody else is.
We got a penalty on that play.
Offside.
Offside. And Carolina will have 30 seconds to try and tie the score up.
And in the fourth quarter, it's when you really have to cash in on those extra man opportunities when you're down a goal. Bringing it into play, far side of the field, that's Brent Vogel.
All six out front on this side, too.
Burnett now over to Pete Vogel, back to Burnett.
Okay, here's the plus side they've got to come to, right there.
That's Ness.
Ness and bang. Oh, nice save. They're trying to work those corners, and Van Arsdale just come up with a very nice save.
Good stick. Works to clear. That's Cypher near side across midfield. They get it to Zashdale. And here comes Zashdale for Hobart. Unsettled situation. And good defense from behind.
Oh, my heavens, the ball leaked through. Now we got a chance. Up. Carolina's got a chance for a fast break.
Here's Burnett.
They have to pull out.
Inside the restraining box, Burnett makes a move. His club down a goal.
There he is. There's
a shot.
Oh, another great save.
High, hard one from Hohmeyer, and Van Arsdale comes up with the save, and here comes North Carolina once again.
Oh, he cracked it up.
I think that came off.
He is equal to the challenge, let's say.
I think that came off his leg or the pipe. Which one?
Billy Ness cranked that one, and Van Arsdale, right there, number 31, did a good job. He's come up with a couple of key saves here in the last couple of moments.
Yeah. This is a fun game.
Oh, yeah. You know, you have to realize what happens when these goalies make some of these impossible saves. They get, most goalies are unbearable to live with anyway, but these guys get just so pumped up that they actually want you to shoot on them because they're so confident.
Yeah, that's right.
Van Arsdale is just looking super.
And with the game he's played, he has good reason to be confident. Here comes Hobart again. They've got the ball. Malvi now on the near side, and that's Morfitt.
Nice play.
Don Malloy. 9:40 left. Hobart clinging to a one-goal
nice
lead.
Move.
Malloy, he's open. Sears with the save.
Sears makes a beautiful save. And we got a whistle.
They called him for stepping in the crease when the goalie had the ball. In this situation, the ball gets automatically moved up to the midline, automatically cleared. That was a rule change that went in last year, I believe. Now, if the goalie didn't have possession, it would have been the goalie's ball behind the goal. But because he had possession, now they get a free clear.
So the free clear gives the ball to Carolina in their offensive end, and Steidel, far side, pass to Seigel.
Joey's got that cannon shot. Let's see if he can get it uncorked.
Crosby for Carolina. Still a lot of time left. 9:15. Carolina down by one at 10-9. There's Pete Vogel, or Brent Vogel, rather. And back outside, that's Crosby. Back to Brent Vogel.
Now, this is the kind of offense I was looking for. Oh, hold on. Now we've got a penalty.
That's going to go against Whalen.
That's the kind of offense I was looking for Carolina all day. That slowed down, that very organized, very disciplined type of offense. Look for the open man.
That's a 30-second penalty. And Hobart's got their long sticks in the game. Get another look at this extra man play.
This is an important goal right here. Here's the play. He's got to come up, draw the man, and flip out here to Holmeyer. They'll try to attack the wings, either this side or the other side.
Burnett behind the net, looks to feed in the hole, can't find anybody. Near side to Holmeyer, all the way
there's
across.
His
Vogel, his shot.
Huh. You're not getting that one in on Van Arsdale.
Van Arsdale's there again, and
Van Arsdale comes
up with the loose ball.
I think the defenseman pulled that one right out of the mouth of the goal.
Yes, he did.
There you go.
Here comes Hobart. They've got Sean Fox.
Hobart continues to rise to the occasion.
And Grimaldi. Hobart with the ball and the lead. 8:16 left in the game.
I think Grimaldi's going to wait a little bit until he got all of his offensive set in there.
You know, one of these times, Carolina's going to not make an opportunity, and Hobart's going to come back and get up two goals on him. Then we're going to see something.
Grimaldi behind the goal.
His there
pass.
It is. Oh.
Morfitt.
He's got a shot if he wants it. Took it away. Took it away.
Now you give it up.
Gave up a shot.
Oh.
And his pass goes out now.
Bad play.
Here we go. This is it. This is where Carolina.
Should have been a body check there. Should have been a body check. Should have put him right down.
And North Carolina gets it into there. And here
too
comes
much stick checking, I think, in there.
You're right.
Burnett. He's going to be picked up by Cipher. The Hobart defense.
Now I thought that. Here's something will happen here. Nice save.
Van Arsdale with another save. I wonder how many he has here in the second half.
And a nice outlet pass. And here's a fast break if you can see it.
That's not a good play. You got to get out of the middle now.
Eckerson now works the ball to Morfitt. Pass on the crease and
nice
shot there by Catalano.
Good
go.
Shot. Great effort.
Constant pressure being placed on Carolina by Hobart. It's incredible the confidence they have going up against the champs.
Unofficially, Van Arsdale with 10 saves here in the second half. Here's Grimaldi.
He got inside Randy Cox. It's the third time he's done that. Absolutely beautiful
play. In fact, it looked like he got hit on the head in the process.
And here it is,
Grimaldi. Watch this roll. Watch this here. Roll inside and bang. I'll tell you, if I'm Tommy Sears, I've got to be saying, well, maybe I better stay in that goal.
I think I might.
Yeah.
I think I might.
11-9, Hobart leads North Carolina, and Grimaldi with four big goals. That one, a real big one. That puts Carolina a little bit of a hole, down two with 6:54 left.
This is what I was talking about. Now Hobart's two up. And Carolina, let's see how they handle the pressure. I don't know. This is a tough situation.
Well, let's just wait and see what happens.
North Carolina comes up with it. That's Brian Rice. And the championship squad realizes they've got their backs to the wall. Let's see if they're up to the task. Ball goes out of bounds to Hobart.
Interesting call there. I think what you'll see there, actually camera work, what happens is the North Carolina man actually goes out of bounds before the whistle blows so that the actual man on the field closest to the ball is in fact the Hobart man.
Try and do it again!
His pressure being applied, I can't blame him. They got to do something.
They played the goaltender and forced the long pass, which is smart lacrosse.
And it's offsides. This is going to be, all right, ball's down. It's an offsides penalty down here on Burnett.
Carl, did you see how close they almost got another goal?
The ball was on the ground. I'm not sure if they could have allowed.